Living on the Edge. I have to admit, you know the Aerosmith song, but I won't force you to listen to me sing it. I am the other Adrian at Netflix. There's actually many of us, but there's two of us that sit next to each other whose last name starts with CO. Adrian Cockcroft, I think, was intending to come over, and we both actually work on the same project, Denominator, and he's the architect, and I've been knee-deep in the code, so either of us are sort of interchangeable for this particular project. I started at Netflix recently in December, and it was kind of an accident, because I went to Netflix to meet with a guy named Ben Christensen, who I saw his project called Hystrix on the Netflix open source website. I don't know, how many here have heard of the Netflix open source portal? So probably, if you haven't, just do Netflix OSS enter in whatever you feel like doing that in, and you'll find images of children's or horror or all these other categories, and then there's names of projects underneath of each of them. Quite comical, the relationships. But Netflix is slowly open sourcing the entire platform, and so there are all of the components that make up the base infrastructure that's above sort of cloud infrastructure, undifferentiated heavy lifting from Amazon, but below sort of like the recommendations engines and how you would actually create a streaming movie service. There's still a lot of code, and that's what the Netflix open source portal is for. So I had been working on some cloud computing stuff, and I noticed some pretty interesting projects there. And so since I live in the Bay Area, I just took a drive over and met with the folks, and I started working there less than a week later. So that kind of happens there too. And if anyone's looking for an interesting commute or a relocation, Netflix is hiring. But suffice to say, Netflix is a very, you can look at it as a large application. And I'm going to talk about how some of those pieces work. And this is, of course, the streaming side of the business. There's also software and everything else involved in the DVD shipping side. The streaming operates out of Los Gatos, California. There's about several hundred engineers. All of them are experienced. So we have a lot of lean teams building things. And so what you'll find over the course of this year is more and more of these things popping up on that open source portal. And what I'm talking about mostly today is called Denominator. So without context, a boatload of open source projects doesn't really do you very much good. There's probably 50 more. So what I'm going to hopefully be able to do by the end of this presentation is show how the technology at Abstract works and how some of these things fit together. And that way you can get some context for what it's like to be in the critical path of streaming and what some of the scaling infrastructure is like. And we'll talk about DNS a fair amount. So what I'll do is I'll try to manage my time pretty well, if I'm good or lucky, to get through the basic top half before the 8 o'clock and leave room for questions, because I understand some folks might want to duck out after 8. So I will leave questions in between here. And if you feel something urgent or it's just completely Greek, feel free to stop me. So you don't waste your time. In case you do jet out halfway through, I don't want you to miss hearing at least an abstract about this cloud price thing. And how many here have already heard of the Netflix cloud price? So it's definitely important that I discuss this now. So Netflix, like I said, has this open source thing. They're not trying to become like a Red Hat or anything, but it's just having a way to collaborate on some of the tooling that we work on. And some of it is going to be using software components you're familiar with. A lot of Netflix architecture is built on top of like Tomcat and Juice, things like this, Wava, how many folks here are familiar with like juice and guava. If you're familiar with Spring and the libraries that you get inside of Spring, juice and guava are another set of sort of common utilities and dependency injection that were made by Google. And so it's a different way. It's not to say one's better or worse, but we have a lot more stuff in that category. Netflix software is not 100% Java, but it's pretty close. So most of the systems, including our data services, which are Cassandra, are JVM based. There's definitely some folks in analytics teams that use R and things like this. And then we have some folks in sort of like our DevOps space that use like a wee bit of Python here and there. But almost all of the meat of Netflix code is Java. So if you have interest in looking at some of the pieces, because they're digestible chunks of software, whether it's the way we present our dashboards and how we weave that together, or how we do some of our library work, or how we actually do log analysis or things like this, there's like lots of reusable chunks. You may find yourself like looking at it like, well, that could be done differently, or oh, I've saw this 100 times. Don't think just because Netflix people wrote it is that they are not interested in your ideas. And to kind of kick that idea a little bit harder, Netflix came out with this cloud price concept. So it was not just like, we welcome community, but we'll give $10,000 prizes to the best contributions to our open source, as well as two tickets and hotel to the Amazon reInvent conference later this year. So there's 10 categories of prizes, and I'll do a little bit more deep later. But suffice to say, there's 10 prizes, each of them $10,000. Things from like portability, new languages, like if you like Clojure or Scala, you find a project you like, but you don't like that it's Java, but you can figure out what, you know, you can find a place. And it's a GitHub driven system. If you're not familiar with GitHub, there's a lot of tutorials about how to work with the distributed version control in the cloud. But if you do Cloud Prize GitHub in Google, you're gonna find a place to get started. I'll show you some more later about the actual categories, but if you happen to duck out before then, I didn't want you to go without knowing what that was. So, anyway, enough meta talk. Let's start. So, this is the homepage that probably more than a few are familiar with, and it does change often. Probably some of you who have used Netflix noticed the page changing. It can actually change sometimes, and you might even notice it while you're logging the next hour. Netflix is constantly doing product testing, and they're constantly deploying new features, sometimes to a subset of users, to try and test out different things. How many here have heard this like A/B testing type of methodology? So a lot of folks, but essentially, what you're trying to do is take a population of users, introduce the feature that you believe is going to enhance their stickiness to your service or whatever your business metrics are, and pilot it. And basically do some tests to see whether it increases whatever you're measuring. In terms of Netflix, it's engagement that we actually track as a metric, like how many hours do people stay on Netflix. So it could be dangerous for some, because we're really good. You'll need someone to bring you pizza. But we hope that folks are healthy. And I did, however, find the Onion spoof on Netflix pretty entertaining. If you're not familiar with it, the Onion, kind of like fake news, had fake news that basically someone was watching Netflix too long, and we sent push notification to see if they were okay. but we actually do have these metrics, so it's kind of interesting. How many here have heard of House of Cards? House of Cards is an original production from Netflix. Kevin Spacey, pretty stellar cast, stellar director, stellar a lot of things. It's a politics show. And when Netflix brought that that series into the portal, you could watch every single episode back to back. And we noticed that there were I forget the number, but it was at least a couple hundred people who had literally done that. And for like, I don't know, 16 or 18 hours straight, just did not stop, and auto-advanced until the season was over. So there's lots of interesting human behaviors, and the analytics team has a very interesting job keeping up with that and making some sensible information out of it. On the infrastructure side, what we see that the product teams are pushing us, trying to figure out how to get not only their products out there or their feature tests in, but also things like painted door tests. If you're not familiar with painted door, it's like you paint a door on a wall and then you see who tries to open it. And then there's a 500 server error miscontinued, right? Sometimes it's not actually a server error. I'm not saying that that's what we do for a painted door, but those are sometimes what you would get with a painted door test. Essentially, the product team might be testing to see whether you're interested in that. It's a lot of like kind of fun facts about the way AB works, but AB helps you take a portal like this and start allowing people to try out ideas and be innovative, and that requires a lot of things, including the ability to deliver and deploy software, so continuous delivery and also continuous deployment. Not all of Netflix does the continuous deployment. We have some teams that are doing continuous delivery. But for example, I think our API team deploys, several times a week or something like that. It's not like the 100 times a day that the extreme continuous deployment might end up with, but it's pretty frequent. The other thing about product testing is you need to know which demographics are you looking at. Netflix does run in many, many countries. And we have different catalogs of content. Obviously, we have different licensing rules for the content. What can we play where? And the product team is interested to figure out if they can narrow down to isolate exactly to see if their hypotheses are supported. And so some of the stuff I'm going to talk about is how some of the geographical stuff works. I'm gonna do a little hand waving first and tell you it's much more complicated. I'm going to talk about DNS. At the end of the day, there's a lot more validation that happens on the servers and redirects and stuff. And if folks are interested in finding out where my knowledge ends, quiz me towards the end of the session. So here's a nutshell. A lot of these slides I literally lifted from the other Adrian, and they're still pretty good. So most folks enter into the blue box. They have a consumer device, might have a silver light player, and this is going to generate some API traffic. How many folks here know that Netflix is a pretty big user of Amazon Web Services? Amazon Web Services does like our undifferentiated heavy lifting for servers and networks and stuff like that. Interestingly, we get a lot of press about that, but most of our content is actually served from CDN, or content distribution network. And that basically is caching the bits, pre-rendered bits from the films. So what happens when we receive content is we render it in various bit rates so that we can, I forget the exact numbers, but it runs the gamut from HD down to lots of different bit rates and variable bit rates between. And that's how we can kind of switch it up as you're playing to try to get you something going. And so we have render farms, essentially, you can think of them like that, that actually process the content and then render it into these different bit rates. And then they're sort of forklifted into the CDNs. CDNs, if you've heard of things like Akamai, they're basically cache nodes, and they try to help keep relatively static content nice and quick, good response times close to the users. I forget the real number, but we have at least in the, I think there's 40,000 DNS entries for our cache, but I don't know, but maybe it might be 50,000, but it's in that sort of magnitude. So actually, most of the things that we manage that have stuff on them are actually in CDN. Amazon, the farms that actually run our services, the first thing you probably hit from consumer devices is our API services, and that's our biggest clusters, actually the API controllers. And those are basically your links. If we were to think of the relationship of the bandwidth, and I don't remember if I have a slide on this or not, a pretty common fact is that Netflix consumes about a third of US bandwidth. That's the download. That's a lot of times people are actually coming via the CDN. It's not coming from Amazon. So, because a lot of, not to say Amazon isn't doing a massive amount of work for us, but I just want, because I know sometimes folks aren't really clear with what that means. If you look at the uplink, you don't really do a lot of uploading to the CDN. So that's actually the stuff that's definitely going via Amazon services. And I think our East Coast presence in Amazon is something around 9,000-10,000 servers. They're pretty beefy Amazon servers. We don't use very much of their little guys. We also recently are deploying load balancers and some light pieces of our stack in the West Coast regions too. So this year we're actually doing a lot more work towards multi-region resiliency, and that's what this denominator project is a part of. So behind all of these sort of shields here and the things that coordinate with each other, we use a lot of Zookeeper, by the way, is all of the various business products and the things that the supporting technology. I told you about the content encoding, and we have various management systems that basically make it possible to connect the content with the user's request coming from the API. We have a lot of quality of service logging and auditing to make sure that we know when our metrics are failing and from where that's going on. This is a fairly good overview, and I'm going to just focus on the large pieces because each of them will break out into infinity if I was going to finish. Open Connect, how many know about Open Connect? It's not that popular for you can go your whole life and not have to deal with crafting your own CDN. But if you wanted to, the appliance hardware specs are listed. The way by which folks can basically become a part of the content delivery network or distribution, whichever definition you prefer to use, is well defined. And so we have been trying to be more open and in the process be able to share bandwidth and cycles from folks who participate with us. So it's a kind of like a co-op for cache content. Here's the slide. So upstream, downstream, right? So this 33 is coming mostly from the CDNs. The 4.5%, it's not all of it is Amazon, but a lot of that is. That's another way of looking at sort of the control traffic. If folks are familiar with MQTT protocol, it's kind of similar. You got a control protocol, you got a data protocol, and a lot of the traffic is the data protocol. So in practice, what this turns into is a big dependency, like everything else, right? So you start at the API servers, which double as sort of like intelligent routers, and they try to coordinate the user's requests with the service, whether they're looking at catalog content, validating whether they can access a catalog, what's the metadata about this device and this user, were they sent to the correct server or not, if they appeared that they were from South America, but this other metadata shows that they're from North America, how do we mediate those type of things? So there's a lot of work that happens at the start of the graph that consumes information from the edges of the graph. And what you're seeing here, actually, this I believe is rendered from AppDynamics. There's a couple companies that have been with us from from a few years when we started going into the cloud. Netflix did start with a data center, and the funny thing is that we're often nowadays with a lot of private cloud technology, we're like, why didn't you guys start your own or try a data center? And it's like, well, we started there. We don't necessarily want to go back. But right now, I believe Netflix is like 99% out of the data center. And one of the key ways for us to do that was we were able to get our HSMs, which is basically the hardware security validation things that are physical devices, into Amazon. And once we were able to do that, we actually were able to migrate a lot more of our stuff. And that's actually how you control access to some of the vendor-specific-y things about hardware appliances.
So is that a special deal you did with Amazon to get your hardware in there, basically?
Yes, but I believe if you look at recent Amazon blogs, you can now lease HSMs. I think it's, I'm not sure, I can't actually verify whether that's the same HSM we use or not, but very recently you can now, they're not cheap, but you can now rent by a certain period of time HSMs. So they're getting a lot more serious about, each year, the type of, regulatory type of technology to get out of Amazon. So pretty interesting stuff. Actually, one of the things about our graph is that we do rely on quite a lot of Amazon Web Services too. So not just the instances, but things like S3, SimpleDB, SQS, CloudWatch, a lot of the data services. I don't know how famous it is, but it's fairly well known that we use Cassandra quite a bit. One of the reasons we use Cassandra is that we can handle cross-region replication. Now, a lot of Netflix data does not require to be globally replicated because a lot of, for example, the catalog data is naturally partitioned closer to the users that we're using. But there is some, there are some data sets that need to be globally replicated either from availability standpoint or convenience standpoint for the user as far as response time. So not all of our data is replicated. Sometimes, for example, it's easier to replicate the job than it is to replicate the data. So in some cases, we might choose to replicate the processing cluster. In some cases, we might choose to replicate the higher value data that was processed. So it depends, and there's a lot of depends when we get to like what good is multi-region. And a lot of it has to do with what time windows does this become critical, if at all. So for example, a lot of our log analytics that we use for production purposes, we wouldn't replicate that. Some of the logs we would, if it was used for different reasons. So we have a lot of interesting technology choices in the Netflix has this sort of freedom and responsibility mantra, which means that the engineers are able to choose whatever technology they want to do their job. We have some folks that were trying Elasticsearch. Now, if you've worked with Elasticsearch, maybe a couple years ago, maybe it wasn't that reliable or something like that. So, but in the context of what you're using it for and what value you're getting from it, and what time in the maturity cycle of a product like Elasticsearch, it might actually be exactly what you need. So we don't have actually top-down decisions about how technology is done. We have some guidance though. We don't really want folks to do a whole lot of multi-region replication products. So we try to encourage use of Cassandra if you're gonna need to do multi-data center replication. And we have, of course, the open source projects that we have and some platforms. So there's encouragement, but for example, the project I'm going to talk about later, Denominator, doesn't use any of it, and it's mainly you're going to be on call. So I mean, how confident are you in this with this technology? Are you going to be up at night with it and be okay with that? So AppDynamics was one of the other companies besides Amazon we sort of have been with for a few years. They do pretty lightweight instrumentation and monitoring, and so we can build these dependency graphs in production, and we can tell, for example, the health or the throughput that we're getting between our nodes doing whatever it is that we're doing. And we can start, we have different views of when problems happen, what's going on. I wouldn't say most popular, but a very high visibility project in the Netflix open source is Asgard. Asgard was featured in the elections, actually, because there's a piece you can probably find someplace where Obama's team had delivered the campaign's technology stack significantly cheaper than the competition, because they used cloud computing and they used Netflix open source and some other things like Chef and to basically run their operations in the cloud and be able to actually run the election campaign much less expensively. Very interesting piece, not just if you're a Netflix employee, it's an interesting piece in there. Asgard was one of the things featured there. This is our replacement, if you will, for the Amazon Web Services console. It's a Ruby, Grails, Gradle, all that stuff. Anything starting with G, R is going to be in the source control. It's very clean. Joe Sundell, who's the lead for this, has done a fantastic job. It allows you to define your application clusters and manage them, do things like upgrades. I have, for example, a cluster running one version of the app. You can see here, Obi-Wan is the name of the app. Version 63 is the version of the image. And we can roll in a canary of version 64, maybe with a couple instances. And if that works, we'll promote it to 500 servers if we need to, or 5 is fine, however much. And migrate traffic back and forth through Asgard. And so that way you can do roll forwards, roll backs. When we have problems, like for example, somebody updated an image and broke something, we can always go back and start old clusters and things like that. So it's a nice operations tool for getting your code out there on load balance servers that are all connected and relationships are all nice and tidy. It has a lightweight workflow that's being built in that will employ Amazon's simple workflow service. Sort of a Muley type of thing that you don't have to manage in middleware for. So it's kind of a nice thing. And it's very Amazon-centric because Netflix is very Amazon-centric. However, the cloud prize includes the category of portability. And so if you have your favorite other type of cloud technology, you can ask or better push a code update to allow it to use something more portable. This gets more into my specific domain. I've been heads down on this for a few months. Portable DNS control. On our way for looking for smiles across services that have to be resilient or at least user relevant across multiple regions, we have to think about how these things can find themselves and how users can find them. And so DNS, domain name service, is the answer to these things, as it has been for many years. I think I'm missing a cloud. Oh, there it is. So one thing that's kind of funny about Netflix is that a lot of people say, oh, well, you're not multi-cloud, you don't do whatever, you only use Amazon, if they know what we're using in cloud. But the most critical part of your infrastructure, I mean, it can be arguably be made, is DNS. If you can't find your servers, your host, if your DNS screws up, everything screwed up. And this is the only service we have that we're actually working with three vendors simultaneously on a regular basis. So it's pretty interesting. It is the outer edge of your network, the thing that's binding your names to other names or IP addresses. And we use three different cloud providers. We use Amazon Route 53, mostly for our mid-tier internal services to connect to each other. So for example, the load balancers have an unfriendly name on them. And we would use Amazon's Route 53 to like say, this is OB1 version 52 cluster, as opposed to ELB hyphen some crazy hexadecimal thing. It also it's helpful. Amazon Web Services tend to have hooks and fancy tricks. So, for example, if one of the servers behind one of the load balancers gets destroyed intentionally or unintentionally, it has some lifecycle hooks to deregister it from DNS automatically for you. So, if you're using, if you're doing a lot of Amazon-specific stuff already, Route 53 is a pretty handy naming service to use, particularly as it has hooks with the other infrastructure. Amazon Route 53 isn't the most feature-rich service out there as far as DNS goes. It doesn't have a lot of fancy features. It has some features like latency-based routing, which means that if you happen to be closer to Sao Paulo or Brazil from a network perspective, then that's the servers you're going to use. But Netflix is a little bit more interested in and sort of who you are than what's your response time. So for example, we're probably more interested to make sure that your server and you are definitely in Sao Paulo, Brazil, as opposed to just being network close. For those of you who don't know the difference, networks are a weird thing, particularly across nations. So for example, if you're in Australia, there's some places where actually going to California will be quicker than going to Japan. So there's not always a straightforward relationship between latency and the way maps are drawn by people in the UN or whatever. So there's an interesting thing. So the one thing to keep in mind is just that geography and jurisdiction don't necessarily have a direct relationship with latency. We use, for our fancier stuff, we use Dynet and UltraDNS. There's a massive overlap between the features that we use between those two. Both of them support very advanced features of DNS, including being able to essentially track, allow a user to only see a mask of certain things depending on where we believe they're coming from. And that's the, well, just lump into geo. They also allow you to do things like load balance records and stuff like that. So, it's pretty fancy stuff, so DNS is simple, but it goes very deep, and it's been developed for 20 years by now. But that's the edge. That's how you figure out. That's what Netflix.com gets resolved into something else. And if you're ever interested in like sort of what Netflix uses, you can also tell by where these. Names are actually registered too. So if you do like dig on Netflix.com, you'll find certain name servers. You can kind of figure it out, and you don't have to wait for me to tell you. Denominator is our project to control these DNS servers portably and programmatically. So firstly, what we do beforehand. So what we did beforehand is that some things we had like ad hoc dump scripts, like some fancy shell scripts or some fancy things to do like bulk loads. Some things were pretty low maintenance, like just using the console and clicking here and there and doing some things. And one of the problems is that, for example, how many here know about the Netflix Christmas Eve debacle? Some of you may have been watching something and had a problem on Christmas Eve. Thankfully, it wasn't Christmas Day, but there were some traffic flow problems. Essentially, traffic got to our load balancer, but then it wasn't forwarded on to the actual instances. So there was a hole, and that was something outside of our control. It happened to be somebody had accidentally nuked some things, and so we have various amounts of different auditing systems that keep track of things. One project on the open source page is called Etta. Etta is like a MongoDB type of thing that helps you keep track of the history of your configuration changes. Like, what was the IP address at this time? Because you'll know that you'll get different IP addresses for certain things. And so you can figure out, okay, at this point in time, everything was like this. Well, we found that we had a lot of stuff, but we didn't have the edge of our network actually captured there. So people were making changes here, but we wouldn't know what they were at the time because we'd have to go into the vendor-specific audit log and try and manually pull that out. So we wanted to make sure that if, you know, we have another Christmas Eve thing, we'll have much more contextual information because we'll have made all those changes ourselves and we'll have dumped them into Cassandra with everything else. And so we'll be able to do a lot faster restores. And we don't currently have like a specific agenda for, you know, hey, screw you, vendor A, we're gonna use vendor B tomorrow. That doesn't really work out well in DNS, but it's more important to have choice and also be able to have one tested way and auditable way to control very important network configuration. So denominator is the project. Denominator as in highest common denominator, which is kind of an interesting interpretation, meaning that we need to expose feature groups. And those feature groups are going to help us understand which of these providers can do things like geo, which of these providers can just name things. And we can work with all of those types of aptitudes, we just need to know what they're capable of doing. I talked to you earlier about NetflixOSS. I'm gonna ship some stickers, they're gonna look like this. So your next job, make sure you come back so you can get them. But this is our part of our open source platform. Denominator is already in production. The project didn't start until late January, I think. It's used to manage our CDN and also to do our geo changes. And I'll talk about that. So here's the use cases. Graph form. Eta is, you know, that's sort of chronological way so you can figure out, okay, when things went bump in the night, these were those things. And this is what they were named at the time. And this is how I could restore to that day before if I needed to. We have a common model and common API. So we've normalized how these things name things and what they look like, and how they would look in JSON or whatever. And then we have a plugin system. And most of the APIs are totally broken. I worked previously and still do work on another project called JClause, which works on different REST APIs or things that call themselves REST. And I would say that the DNS automation APIs are some of the worst I've ever seen. Like it's got SOAP or weird redirect mess APIs. Like there's all sorts of craziness. And so it wasn't easier. And one of the things that's problematic is just the differences between how things identify users and what kind of access controls they get. So one of the things that you end up needing to do is proxy those. We use Asgard, uses a service called One Login, not One Password, I also use that. But One Login is essentially like a single sign-on type of LDAP thing or Active Directory thing or whatever that you want to use to manage your user role relationships. So we sort of masquerade and then dance around very primitive authentication and authorization systems. The feature sets that we needed that were most important to us were to do changes in batches. So for example, almost all of our sites have multiple servers, or at least, I mean, they definitely have multiple load balancers. Many have 300 servers behind them. There's different granularities in naming. We need to do work in appropriate levels of batching. We have to be able to handle the more advanced records, like load balanced records or ones with territory tags and metadata on them cleanly. It was a top level goal to be able to play nice with Cassandra and also play nice with JSON stores like Mongo. So we had to make sure that our model didn't look, feel, or act quirky, and also not to do too much. This is a combination of personal preference and also the idea that you end up with this massive call dependency graph in Netflix anyway. So you don't want to do too much because it's already hard enough to deal with the API front end, which ends up with several hundred microservices behind it. Try to be very careful and don't over-engineer anything. However, we have a caveat that we definitely want to do cool things regardless. So that's the balanced. So denominator is sort of a provider lookup-y thing. And so we have a variable length way to pass in credentials, which would relate to how many parts that particular backend service has. Some backend services have multi-part credentials, like three pieces or two pieces. Some of them you could actually pass a token or a renewable thing, like an OAuth-y thing. Like there's many ways. That would be a very long discussion to talk about the idea of credentials. But you get a context to something, and then we give a very primitive API back. This is highly intentional. So iterator. Now, it's an interesting one because actually Ben, from the guy that I ended up joining after talking to, has done a Java port, or his team actually have done a Java port of the .NET Rx style, which is functional reactive, which essentially, you know, inverting iterator and basically sending you, it's like observer pattern, basically. And so anytime you use iterator, you could just as well use observer as well. But what we try to do is do like, you know, very, very lean depths and also make sure everything is completely lazy. And so the iterators you get back will lazily pull from the network as it goes along. Sometimes we're talking about 50,000 records on very slow APIs. So as soon as you find something, stop. If you have any way to delegate that work, do it, please. We didn't do iterable. Iterable is common. It's kind of like a cheap in Java because of the for form, where you can do like the shortcut form, like for x colon, you know, iterable. Mm-hmm. But iterable contract is wonky. I mean, it requires you to be able to reproduce that stream. And so that means you either cache stuff, which is kind of bad, or you keep like a very stateful connection, which is also kind of bad, and it's only just to give you a shortcut form for markup. So people don't like iterator, but we, you know, there's millions of tools, especially in Guava, to convert iterators to iterables if you so desire, and you can eagerly pull everything if you want to or do whatever you need. So we just figured that it's a better punch to say if you want it iterable, you know, list or set or whatever, just, you know, there's a million ways to do that. But it's more important to focus on the job. So this is sort of like a library for a bare bones integration. The DNS lingo is important. You saw this zone thing. Zone, some people kind of call it subdomain. Pretty much any word you use, either subdomain or zone, is going to be confusing. But just say it's a administrative unit for some part of the DNS tree. And it's very important to understand that DNS is a tree. It's you know, rendered dot delimited. But just because, for example, you could have like you know, employees.denominator.io, it doesn't actually mean that that's a sub, you know, a subtree. It can be over. DNS is weird. So they just use a zone as far as a thing that is a part of a tree that can be transferred someplace else, and that holds records. And so normally the zone, if you're just using DNS normally, that's just going to be your subdomain, whatever. And it's going to have records in it, where you're going to create a record in it. And records, most importantly, people are familiar with the name part. The type part, CNAME or A, are the two most popular records, and they're the ones that most people kind of don't use properly. Not because it's hard, it's just because it's confusingly named. Like, CNAME means canonical name, and so sometimes people, they get confused about this name and the intent of CNAME. The type always refers to what the R data is. And that's how you can keep this straight. A lot of times, CNAME versus A, a lot of people mess up the difference. A stands for address, and that means that the last part is going to be an address, IPv4 address. CNAME says canonical name. It's not talking about this. Just like address is talking about that, this is also talking about that. It's the canonical name, the one name. Now, in DNS, it's actually very annoying that canonical name means the one name, because because if we're talking about a resilient service, you don't want the one name, you want many names, because you want many options. If you've ever done, how many people have heard of like round robin or DNS round robin? Essentially, if you have a record, you can have multiple IP addresses come back, and your client can just circulate through them however they feel like it. So, for example, even if they can't talk to the DNS server again, they have multiple choices. And so they can, you know, pick the third address, or they can put some splay and randomizer and just, you know, get through the addresses. If it's canonical name, by contract, it can only return one value. So this is a load balancer, but we have two load balancers. So this is a kind of a little bit of a pain when you're doing like highly available systems. Because TTL means how long do you wait before you contact the DNS server again to get a new value? Now, just like you can do round robin on the client side, you can do round robin on the server side. That's a special thing. And the server can just vary this value each time somebody asks. But the DNS clients are probably going to pay attention to this. And sadly, if they don't pay attention to that, it probably means they're not going to ask again at all. So CNAMEs are a bit of a pain. Because you have to understand that some devices don't play nice with the time to lives, and availability is kind of defined to a certain degree by the client's ability to ask again, or at least ask for multiple things. So CNAMEs are kind of hard. CNAMEs are a reality in Amazon, though, because you have no API to get the IP addresses of their load balancer. And this is kind of like an interesting thing, and I don't mean to get too weedy here, but the Amazon load balancer is basically a bunch of HTTP proxy servers. And they cobble them together, and then they give you a name that will resolve to a bunch of their IP addresses. And that name looks like this. You know, it's like my ELB, whatever. I probably want to name it this. But I can't get access to the IP addresses, so I can't give my client the direct control that I want to just do client-side stuff. There's exceptions to it, but this is one of the major problems when you're doing system architecture with DNS, is knowing it's normally only this A versus C name or quad A. I mean, one thing that not a lot of people know is that I think 5% of our traffic is coming from IPv6 for Netflix. So some people say, oh, IPv6 doesn't exist, but it is, and that is used quite often. So it's an interesting thing. But anyway, for IPv6, CNAME is still the same thing. It's more about the reverse lookup stuff. And the A is IPv4 only. AAAA, quad A, is for the IPv6. So there's two different types if you're using IPv6. Record set is, and I'll wrap it up when I'm almost on the DNS side. Record set is basically everything that has same name and type. So for example, we said name is www.whatever, and CNAME. A record set would be everything that has that same query tuple, these two things. In the case of CNAME, you can only have one value, right? Because that's by spec, the only thing you do. But if you have an A record, you could have many, many IP addresses in the same record set. It's implicitly the case they should have the same time to live, which is the value by which the server's asking, telling the client they should ask again. But it's possible for them to not have the same. And just to kind of solidify it, you know, if the same name has four IP addresses, they're the same record set. And the most important concept for this is actually signing records. Not many people use it; it's a lot of maintenance. But you can actually basically sign the entries that you put into DNS, so people can validate that they actually came from Netflix and not by somebody. The last things to talk about is the vocab is the difference between name server and resolver. Name server is the thing listening for DNS requests. typically on port 53. That's why Amazon's service is named Route 53. It's a play on words for Route 66, and but it's talking about port 53 as in the UDP or TCP port. Resolver is the thing on the client. It doesn't matter if that's your, you know, Roku or your PS3 or whatever it is. It has a DNS resolver somewhere in the stack. And so it doesn't really matter what technology it is. It's whatever is actually making the request and asking, you know, okay, I've got this tuple. I need www.whatever and a CNAME. And that's what's the resolver about. API, I'm kind of scoping to just say the thing that controls the configuration on the servers. API means everything, but in the scope of this discussion, that's what I'm doing. So, this is the start of the internals. This is what we'll get when we finish our break. Denominator does not use Spring. Neither does it use Juice. It uses Dagger. So, if you want to do a quick GitHub while you're getting beer, that's what we're going to hop into when you're finished drinking it.